Hello everybody, hope you're all doing well. My name is Steven, and this is the Storytime Channel. Today we have some malicious compliance stories, and our first story of the day is by Grizzly. You want to play games? Sure, but I bet I'm better at them. I drive a truck out of the same warehouse every night. I show up at midnight, get my paperwork, and deliver the load on that paperwork. Most nights I get the same run, which is scheduled to leave the warehouse at 2:30. I show up so early in case they need me to pull a different load. I've been there close to 2 years now and always got along with everybody for my first year. About 9 months ago, they hired a new dispatcher, the person who hands me my paperwork. And she started implying she was interested in me. She would compliment my looks and ask about my day and stuff like that. After a few months of this, I asked her out, she agreed, I scheduled a date, and all was well. When the date came up, she canceled last minute and asked to reschedule. She never got back to me, and I never reached out again. No big deal, this is pretty typical behavior in modern dating. We still saw each other at work and got along well enough. I treated her like any other coworker, and she did the same. That is, until about 3 months ago, anyway. I came in and got my normal run, which leaves at 2:30. Since I have some time to kill, I go hang out with a buddy who's close by, something I do quite often, and everyone is cool with it. As long as I deliver on time, that's all that matters. I came back at 1:45 and found out my truck needed repairs, so I went into dispatch and asked for a different one. The dispatcher gets snotty and starts yelling at me about how they couldn't track me. We are constantly monitored by GPS while on duty, but I wasn't on duty yet, so there's no need to track me. I argued back for a little bit and eventually just sighed and said, "Can I please just get another truck so I can deliver on time like I had planned?" She throws a key at me and I go do my job just as well as any other day. All goes well for the next 2 months or so. I still see her every day, but I keep conversation to a minimum and do my job. One day, I come in and find out they don't have a load for me. That's not uncommon, and I get paid just to be on call, so I'm content. I go hang out with a buddy, as usual, and await the call to either come in for a load or get relieved for the day. She calls at about 1 a.m. and says, "Come in when you get a minute." I say okay, and she hangs up. I show up in about 5 to 10 minutes, and she tells me that another driver didn't show up for his shift, so she called me in for his run. He actually showed up a few minutes late, between the phone call and my arrival, so she gave him his usual run and said they didn't have anything for me. She then proceeds to scold me for taking too long to get there, saying the load would have been late. I would have had about 4 hours to do a 2.5 hour drive. It wouldn't have been late. At this point, I'm 99% sure she's screwing with me, so I just say, okay, and I turn around and leave. About 20 minutes later, I get another call saying I have a run. I go in and get the paperwork to start my day. This run was on a tight schedule due to poor planning. It could have left the warehouse earlier, but it didn't, and now there's only a 15-minute margin of error. I notice there's an issue with the trailer. It's nothing dangerous, but it's technically illegal and shouldn't be on the road. Normally, I would just pull the trailer and report the issue when I got back since it isn't dangerous, but not today. I bring the trailer to the on-site shop for repairs, but the mechanic couldn't fix it. At this point, dispatch is calling me asking why I hadn't left the warehouse yet, so I fill them in. I tell them I'm not pulling a trailer with any flaws and we need to load the product into another trailer. They agree because it's illegal for them to make me drive a vehicle I'm not comfortable with, and we get started. It took about an hour to move the contents of the trailer into a new one, so at this point, I'm running about 30 to 45 minutes late. I just sat in my truck browsing Reddit while the warehouse did all the work. I ended up getting to my delivery about an hour late, which makes dispatch and the whole company look bad. I apologize to the customer and explain the problem. I've delivered there before and they like me, so it's all good. Dispatch hasn't played any games with me since. I'm hoping they got the message that I won't be a pushover. So considering how the date went or didn't go, really, do you think the dispatcher was just being friendly in the beginning? Or do you think that there was some kind of interest and that played a role into why they're acting so strangely by the end of the story? Let me know in the comments down below. Our next story is by Throw SS Posters. Fix your own drill. For background, my dad worked as a diamond driller for many years. When I say diamond, that's what the drill was coated with to cut through rock. They were actually mining gold. Diamond is super hard, yo. Part of being a driller is fixing your own equipment. When your job site is a mile underground, down some dark tunnel, you learn to be self-sufficient. My dad has always been a mechanical genius. He can visualize the inside workings of an engine just by observation. He's the guy who will listen to your car for 3 minutes and go, "It's X." Then you replace part X, and magically, all the lights in your dash disappear. So this is a story of unwritten rules. As a miner, it was part of the deal that you fix your equipment. At the time of this story, the miners were getting paid by the foot. If you were productive and drilled so many feet, you get good wages. If you were a slacker, you didn't get much. The perils of piecework. Good sometimes, awful at others. The catch, you need to upkeep your drill. Ain't nobody taking the cage, slang for the underground elevator, down half a mile into the dark, walking down some forsaken tunnel just to replace the bolt that was holding your drill bit in place. That upkeep was 100% on the driller. Fair or not, that's the way it was. So the unwritten rule was, you break it, you fix it. Nobody wants to spend their whole shift fixing things when they could be drilling and making money. Enter the cross shift. So each drill was usually manned by two people. They were cross shifts. One guy works 12 a.m. to 12 p.m., the other 12 p.m. to 12 a.m. That way the equipment is always running, no downtime. Cross shift was mechanically challenged. Would drill all day, wreck the equipment, and it would be fixed by my dad next shift. Win-win for cross shift. Thing is, dad had to fix the drill to make money. It was piecework, as you remember. So he started getting frustrated. It's hard to make money when you're always repairing things. Extra crappy when it wasn't even your fault to begin with. After probably too long and too many ignored requests, yes, he talked to supervisor, no, it didn't help anything, dad found a workaround. He would show up to the drill, fix it as fast as possible, then drill like a boss for his shift. When money-making time was over, he would break the drill in the exact way it was broken when he started the shift, forcing the cross shift to pull his weight and fix the equipment, or face a shift of not making money. Mysteriously, the drilling equipment started being repaired before dad showed up to work, almost like cross shift figured out he had to fix his problems himself. Funny how that happens sometimes. It sounds like OP's dad is a good man, being more than willing for probably way too long to kind of baby these guys and do the work that they should have been doing for them. And I definitely don't envy them because that's some hardcore work. My hat's off to them. And our final story of the day is by Icaros Swing Zero. Give me a raise or replace me. About a decade ago, I worked in a call center doing over-the-phone tech support. I worked there for almost 7 years until I was fired because the desk phone they issued me malfunctioned for 6 weeks straight, despite my continued twice-a-week complaints. They didn't even try to appeal my unemployment either. Anyway, I started there in 2008, and by 2010, I had switched from a customer service role to a tech support role, and then moved into a more senior tech support role, which did not come with extra pay. My job consisted primarily of calling customers back who had an issue that normal tech support was unable to resolve. If I had time, I was expected to help call back customers who left dissatisfied surveys as well. I was also given certain blocks of time during the week to monitor the interdepartmental chat room to help answer questions. I also had a lot of documentation to do to keep track of everything I did and said to a customer. I take pride in my work. Once I learned the ins and outs of the system, I became rather competitive. Each survey or escalation had an associated ticket. We were expected to close 60 tickets per month per person. This equated to just under 3 a day. In order to close a ticket, we either had to resolve their issue, or at least note their additional survey feedback, escalate their issue to the corporate office, to die, more on that later, or leave 3 voicemails over 3 days and send them an email. Once I was comfortable with what I was doing, my goal became not to close the most tickets, but to absolutely destroy everyone else in how many I got done. The minimum was 60 per month, and there was a couple people in our 12-person apartment who never broke 100 and were normally doing 50 to 70 a month. Most people were in the 100 to 200 range, a few sometimes getting up to 250. I regularly did 400 or more every month for almost 3 years. I had days where I would make 75 phone calls a day. I also monitored the chat room, often more than required, wrote articles for our internal database, helped our slowest members with paperwork, answered incoming frontline emails if they were behind, and had low-level agents directly transfer live customers to me rather than escalating them if I knew I could resolve their issue right away. Towards the end of that 3 years, I also began helping out another department that dealt with customers who mailed their device in for repair. It wasn't that I was so much smarter than everyone or ridiculously good at troubleshooting, I am just organized and driven. When we had a slow month where almost nobody called us at all, I only did 125 tickets and read probably 7 hours a day. I read Stephen King's Dark Tower series in a week, entirely at work. The company I worked for, the one who signed my paychecks, was a contract company owned by a big multinational out of Canada. They took contracts from companies like DirecTV, Comcast, and USAA. I found out that the company I was doing contracted work for paid my company $35 an hour for my time, but I only saw $10.50 of that. I also was almost never allowed overtime, maybe 1 to 2 weeks a year for the entire 7 years. First level leaders were salaried and, if they didn't work any overtime, made about $12.70. I heard that the next level leader made about $60,000 a year and the building director double that. The company that made the product I was troubleshooting was like a dumpster fire. They sold a product that developed a hardware issue, which they knew was a hardware issue, but they forbid us from telling a customer that and instead told them that we were working on a software update. Despite being primarily in the USA, our website only offered user manuals in Spanish, and the website developer claimed that it was impossible to add a new tab for user manuals to the website. A coworker recoded the website, hosting new pages on a personal server and linking every outside link, like to another part of the website, in just 45 minutes and presented it to our corporate office. Our warranty only allowed for repair. We would not ship out a replacement device and would not provide any sort of loaner device. Minimum repair time was 3 weeks, and the customer was responsible for shipping the device in, including paying for shipping and a box. If it got lost on the way, it wasn't our problem. Apparently, our repair center decided that first in, first out wasn't a convenient system for processing the repairs, so they just pulled however they felt like it. I had the pleasure of calling customers who had mailed their device in over a year prior because it wouldn't even power on to tell them that it was now out of warranty and we no longer had any parts to repair it anyway, and would they like us to mail it back to them? Now comes the malicious compliance. The first came in when the company tried to launch an in-house made data backup service. It was extremely poorly developed and failed miserably. Much better and free systems existed, and even if the company system had worked flawlessly, it had no benefits that I could see. When we started receiving complaints that it was not working, our corporate office told us to just immediately escalate to them. Don't even troubleshoot. I knew nothing was ever going to come of that, of letting cases just trickle in. I knew that corporate would just let them die. So I came in one day and I took all of the pending cases for issues with the backup service and entered them into the ticket service program. Now this is where it got really good. At the time, when you created a ticket, it would send you 3 emails by the time you had finished. That's before leaving notes or closing it, just entering information. I knew this, and I knew I could change the responsible person on the ticket from myself to the person at corporate in charge of this issue at the beginning instead of assigning it to them at the end. I entered 128 tickets for that issue alone that night. I was working second shift at the time. It only took me a few hours. I had plenty of time to do real work after that. That means the person at corporate who was supposed to handle these cases came into work the next day with over 350 new emails in their inbox. When I got to work the following day, I was told we were no longer escalating those issues and instead just telling customers that we were working on fixing it. Those customers never got called back, and the person at corporate later lost their job because they barely ever got anything done. My last malicious compliance came when they started letting people work from home. They did this to save on operating costs as they expanded the workforce. By moving associates to work from home, this was 2012, they didn't have to pay for electricity or as much bandwidth, etc. If you worked from home, you were issued a terminal and keyboard/mouse and a phone. You had to supply a monitor, and the system was a virtual machine. When an opportunity came up to switch to work from home, I put in for it. They moved people in groups as they purchased new equipment. When they found out that I wanted to work from home, they tried to talk me out of it because I wouldn't be able to do escalations and surveys at home. I would have to be frontline tech support again. I asked if I could have a raise then. I was already topped out and knew I would never get a raise ever. They said no, so I chose to work from home. My main reason for working from home was actually money. I didn't get a pay cut, and I was spending a lot of money on gas because I lived 25 miles from work, and gas was over $4 a gallon at the time. Working from home was like 50 cents an hour because I was spending $20 a week on gas. Working from home was also great for me because I could work in my pajamas and didn't waste over an hour driving to and from work. I never understood why they wouldn't let me do what I had been doing before from home. I had all the same tools at home as in the call center. When I left my old apartment to work from home, I was doing at least 25% of the work for the entire department. I was closing 400 and 500 tickets a month and still wasting an hour or two every day. They ended up needing to move 3 people into the department to replace me. I stayed with the company for 3 years after that, mostly because the work was easy and I wasn't particularly motivated to find something better. I ended up getting fired in the end. Like I said, they issued me a desk phone. It was like a landline phone, but had an LCD screen with some configurable options on it, and you could plug in a headset, and it worked over the internet. About 6 weeks before I got fired, my phone started having an issue where it would drop calls. Normally, it would ring and you would press answer, but it started having an issue where it would ring once, or half a ring, or sometimes no ring at all, and then hang up on the customer. Sometimes it would then place me in a state where I couldn't take calls again until I pressed a button on the phone. I notified my supervisor immediately when it first happened and continued to do so twice a week over the next 2 weeks. Despite my repeated complaints, I was told to just watch it, and she refused to send me out a replacement. A week before I was fired, I was working on a day when my supervisor was not. A different supervisor saw that I was in this unavailable state, and despite me telling him that it was my desk phone and that it had been happening for weeks, insisted on giving me a formal verbal warning. When my supervisor came in the next day, she immediately called me and told me she was upgrading my verbal warning to a final written warning. The company, like many, had a 4-step system of verbal, written, final written warning, and then terminated. She gave no reason for why she was upgrading it to a final written. A few days later, I noticed that one of my tools was not working correctly, but managed to struggle through until lunchtime when I restarted my terminal. After lunch, when I restarted, I was unable to log back in. I immediately texted my boss. We had to clock out for lunch. I didn't want to be in more trouble, and I didn't want to be underpaid either. I then called our help desk, but I was back on second shift, so it was after hour support and they were unable to help me. It was a Friday night and they said that normal help desk personnel wouldn't be available until Monday morning. I hung up and called my boss instead. It went to voicemail. I continued to try and reach out to my boss Saturday, Sunday, and Monday via text, phone, and email. I had been scheduled to work all weekend. I normally had days off in the middle of the week, but couldn't do so as I was unable to log into my terminal or phone. Monday morning, I called the help desk again and was told that I wasn't part of the company anymore, but there was no listed reason as to why, and there was obviously nothing they could do as the help desk. My boss finally reached out to me on Wednesday via text and said that I had been fired for call avoidance. I filed for unemployment. It was denied, but when I appealed, the company didn't even have someone call into the phone interview, so I won by default. I was on unemployment for 6 weeks before starting at my current job. Since then, I have gotten 2 promotions and I'm currently making more than double what I made at my old job. To top it all off, last year the company lost a class action lawsuit for making people sign into their terminals and open software before clocking in. They didn't want to pay people for those 5 or so minutes a day, and they lost millions of dollars. I got a check for a few $100 out of it, which was a nice touch. Basically, in my opinion, this is a trashy company with a trashy operation going on. Everything is falling apart and shortchanged and underhanded, and even when it's happening to their own people, they don't give enough of a care about it. OP was better off to try and find a different opportunity, and I'm happy for them that they did. But with that being said, that's all the time we have for today. So if you have a favorite story of the day, let me know which story and why in the comments down below. But besides that, if you enjoyed the video, please consider giving it a like. And if you haven't, subscribe and turn notifications on so you'll never miss an upcoming video. No matter what you do, whether it's just viewing the video, liking, subscribing, turning notifications on, I appreciate the heck out of it. Every little thing that you do helps the channel grow that much more, and I can't thank you enough for it. So until next time, I hope you all have a wonderful day, and I'll be right here next time on the Storytime channel.